4 out of 3 students struggle with fractions. And if you didn't catch that, please watch this to the very end. Knowing how to properly add, subtract, multiply, and divide fractions is going to help you with these major chemistry topics. Recall that a fraction consists of the numerator, which is the number on top, and the denominator, which is the number on bottom. All right, let's start with reviewing how to properly multiply two fractions together. For multiplication, you do not need a common denominator. It's fine that these numbers are different. All we have to do is multiply each number straight across to get our answer. For this next example, we can multiply straight across to get this, and note that this fraction is not completely simplified, meaning both numbers can be divided by the same number, which is 3. The correct answer here is 2/5. We could have approached this question differently and seen that these 3s are across from each other, and when numbers are being multiplied and are across from each other, meaning one is on the denominator and the other is on the numerator, we can cancel them out. So we could have canceled out the 3 immediately to get our answer of 2/5. Now, when multiplying a whole number with a fraction, we can turn this whole number into a fraction by placing a 1 as the denominator. We can do this with any whole number. So for this example, we can see that since these 2s are across from each other, we can cancel them out to get 15. This type of example is commonly seen in balancing chemical equations. To balance a chemical equation, we must have the same number of elements on each side. Start with writing all the elements on each side. Then figure out how many of each element you have. On the reactant side, we have 4 carbons since there is a 4 subscript. We have 10 hydrogens and 2 oxygens. On the product side, we have 1 carbon since there is no subscript shown. And there are 2 plus this oxygen here, so 3 total oxygens. And 2 hydrogens. I recommend leaving hydrogen and oxygen to the very end, especially the oxygen. We do this because oxygen is typically found in multiple locations in a chemical equation, so it's best to leave this to the end once all other elements are balanced. So we'll start with balancing the carbons. This means we want 4 carbons on each side. We need to make the product side be a 4, so we will do this by placing a 4 in front of the CO2. We are not allowed to break molecules or compounds apart. Always place the coefficient in front of the entire compound or molecule. Now that something changed, we have to account for this change by recounting how many carbons and oxygens we have. It is like we are distributing this 4 to both elements. There are 4 carbons and 4 times the 2 subscript to give us 8 oxygens here. But don't forget to add this additional oxygen to get 9 total oxygens. And the amount of hydrogen stays the same. The carbons are now balanced, so we'll move on to the hydrogens. There are 10 hydrogens, and we want 10 hydrogens on the product side. We'll work backwards here and think what number would multiply by 2 to get 10. This number is 5. Now we'll distribute the 5 to each element and recount. There are now 10 hydrogens and 5 plus 8 here, so 13 oxygens, and carbon stays the same. Note, we are not taking the numbers we found previously and adding them together. Instead, we are recounting each time we place a new coefficient on a side. The only thing left to balance are the oxygens, but there is no whole number we can place here that would multiply with 2 to give us 13. This is where our fractions come in. If we were to place a fraction of 13/2, this would give us 13 oxygens. We found this fraction by putting the number we want the oxygens to be on the numerator, and the denominator comes from the subscript of the oxygen. The final step here is to cancel out the denominator and just have whole numbers as our coefficients. So we will multiply the entire equation by the same number as the denominator, which is 2. Remember, if there is no coefficient in front, then assume it is 1. Distribute the 2 to each coefficient. 2 times 1 gives us 2, and 13/2 times 2 is this setup we covered in example 3, where the 2s would cancel out to give us 13. Continue distributing to get 4 times 2 and 5 times 2. This is our balanced chemical equation. Moving on to dividing fractions. You'll need to know what a reciprocal is. A reciprocal is the flipped version of a fraction. When dividing fractions, we are actually multiplying by the reciprocal of the second fraction. Once we change the division symbol to multiplication and flip the original fraction to its reciprocal, then we can multiply straight across to get our answer. This example could have been written like this, but we would approach it the same way. Just know that these are two different ways we could represent division. Knowing how to divide fractions will help you find the proper units for several types of chemistry problems. This specifically is found in kinetics when finding the units for the rate constant. If we wanted to divide these units, we would first separate this to show the division symbol and make this unit into a fraction. If there is no denominator shown, then we can place a 1 as our denominator. Next, we can change the division symbol to multiplication and flip this fraction to its reciprocal. We can now cancel out any like terms. There are 3 m's here and only 1 m here, so we are subtracting an m on the denominator. We now have a number 1 left on top here and m squared on the denominator. Finally, multiply straight across to get this as our answer. Moving on to adding and subtracting fractions. For adding and subtracting fractions, the denominators must be the same number. This is called a common denominator. We are not allowed to just add straight across. Instead, we will find a common denominator first. This goes back to the idea of the least common multiple, where both of these numbers have a multiple of 4. So our least common multiple is 4, which means that is our common denominator. The only fraction that does not have a denominator of 4 is this one. So we will multiply by 2 to both the numerator and denominator to get our common denominator of 4. Now that both fractions have a common denominator, we will only add the numerators together. The denominator will stay the same as 4, and this is our answer. Here's another example. Since we are subtracting, we still need a common denominator, so we can find the least common multiple. Both lists of multiples have 15 in common. Thus, this is our least common multiple and our common denominator. We will multiply each fraction by the number needed to get the denominator to 15. So this fraction will be multiplied by 5 to both the numerator and denominator to get our new fraction. And this second fraction will be multiplied by 3 to both the numerator and denominator to get our other new fraction. Now that both fractions have a common denominator, we will only subtract the numerators from one another. The denominator will stay the same as 15, and this is our answer. Knowing how to add and subtract fractions will be useful specifically for Hess's law. Hess's law is used to find the change in enthalpy of a reaction by combining multiple chemical equations together. Enthalpy is the heat absorbed or released by the system. Think of enthalpy as heat transfer. In a Hess's law question, there will always be what I like to call the goal reaction, because you are trying to manipulate and combine the multiple chemical equations given to look like the goal reaction. 3 rules to know when you manipulate and combine each chemical equation are: Rule 1, if you have to flip or reverse a reaction, you must multiply the change in enthalpy by -1. Rule 2, if you multiply an entire chemical equation by a number, you must multiply the change in enthalpy by that same number. Rule 3, add up all the chemical equations that you either changed or didn't change to make sure you get the goal reaction, and add up all the enthalpies together to get the overall enthalpy change of the reaction. Let's do an example. We are asked to find the enthalpy change of the reaction, and we are given the goal reaction. Start with checking if all reactants and products in the goal reaction are in the given chemical equations on the correct side and if the quantities are the same. We'll start with the first reactant. Locate where H2 is in the given chemical equations. So here, it's on the correct side, but there is only 1 H2 and we need 3. So we will apply rule 2 and multiply the entire chemical equation by 3 and multiply the enthalpy change by 3. We'll rewrite the new chemical equation by distributing the 3 to each coefficient. If no coefficient is shown, assume it is 1. 3 times 1 is 3, 3 times 1/2 is 3/2, and 3 times 1 is 3. So this is our new chemical equation, and 3 times the enthalpy change is this. We'll check the second reactant. carbon is on the correct side, but there is only one carbon and we need two. So again, we will apply rule two and multiply the entire chemical equation by two and multiply the enthalpy change by two. We'll rewrite the new chemical equation by distributing the two to each coefficient. If no coefficient is shown, assume it is one. This is our new chemical equation, and two times the enthalpy change is this. The third reactant is next. Since O2 is found in multiple locations, we will leave this towards the end to see if we need to flip the reaction, multiply, or it might just work itself out. Now, check the product. Though the quantity is the same, it is on the reactant side instead of the product side, so we must apply rule one and flip the chemical equation and multiply the enthalpy change by negative one. We'll rewrite the new chemical equation by flipping the reaction. So the products are now the new reactants, and the reactants are the new products. And our enthalpy change is now positive. Next step is applying rule three, which is to add up all the new chemical equations. We will place all reactants together and all products together. Cancel out like terms that are on opposite sides of the arrows. We can cancel out the two CO2s and the three H2Os. Now let's add our O2s together. We are adding fractions here. Remember, to turn a whole number into a fraction, we will place a one as its denominator. Since we are adding fractions, we must find a common denominator. Our common denominator is two. So we will multiply both the numerator and denominator of this first fraction. Add the numerators together and leave the denominator the same. We now get 7/2. Not done yet. There are still three O2s on the product side. Whenever the same compounds or molecules are on opposite sides of the arrows, we subtract. So we are subtracting 7/2 and three. We again will change this whole number into a fraction by placing a denominator of one. Since we are subtracting fractions, we need a common denominator, which is two. Multiply the numerator and denominator by two and subtract only the numerators while leaving the denominator the same. The 1/2 will stay on the side where the larger fraction was, so the 1/2 will stay on the reactant side. You will know if you did this correctly if you get the goal reaction as your final result, which we do, and the last step is to add up all the enthalpy changes together to get the overall enthalpy change of the reaction, which is what this question was actually asking for. Now it's time for you to try out the practice problems for this topic. Click the link in the description to find all the practice problems with step-by-step answers. Then once you are done with that, come back to watch the next video.